great sustainer. The great sustainer. Psalms 55:22. Cast your burden on the Lord and he shall never permit the righteous to be moved. He will sustain you. I want to talk to you for a moment today on the sustaining power of the constantly praying church. The sustaining power of the constantly praying church. Here's a quote on prayer. I know of no better thermometer to the church's spiritual temperature than this, the measure of the intensity of their prayer. You can get people to show up for just about anything if you have donuts and pizza. You can get people to show up to cut grass, pick up stuff, paint walls. You can get people to honestly show up to do a lot of things. Now, not this doesn't go for this church because you people are perfect and awesome. But prayer meetings. Now, again, we're an anomaly because our prayer meetings, which is the last Monday, little known secret, last Monday of every month. And no, we're not going to ask you to pray out loud. And no, you don't have to stay the whole time. And no, it's not formal. And no, it's not weird. I'm trying to remove all the no's for you. Yes, you can bring your kids. You know, like, anyway. You know, we have hundreds of people that show up to those. But that's not normal in the church. A church that doesn't pray moves from a church that is a movement to a monument. You know what monuments are for? Monuments are to be looked at. They're to be polished. They're to be cleaned. See, if we were a monumental church, you would have walked in, if that's the kind of church you enjoy, at a monumental church, after a week like we just had, you walk in, you see some glitter on the floor, and you see some rows that aren't exactly straight, you know, and maybe some new writing on one of the bathroom walls. Now, I hope not. I hope not, because we're trying to be a church of excellence, and that team did an incredible job cleaning up. Not the point. Point is, you would find something wrong and say things like, I thought the kids had their own room. Well, then that's like, then that flows into too hot. It's too cold. Who picked that song? Who's got the volume button? It's too loud. Can't hear it. Can't find a parking spot. I wish so many people would quit coming to church. I can't find a parking spot. Dear God, what's wrong with this place? I ain't coming back next week. Had to wait 6 minutes for a parking spot. Here in about a month and a half, you'll get up at 7, you'll drive 3 hours, you'll tailgate for 4 hours, and hopefully you'll invite me. I love it, but I'm just saying, ain't nobody griping about parking. We want to remain a church that's a movement, amen? A church that is a movement is a church that is a praying church. Acts chapter 12. Verses 5 through 11. It's a really, really neat passage and account. And I want you to pay very close attention to this idea of constant prayer throughout the points of the message. Good? Acts 12, 5 through 11. Peter was therefore kept in prison, but constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. And when Herod was about to bring him out that night, Peter was sleeping, bound with two chains between two soldiers, and the guards before the door were keeping the prison. Now behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the prison, and he struck Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, "Arise quickly," and his chains fell off of his hand. Then the angel said to him, "Gird yourself and tie on your sandals." So he did. And he said to him, "Put on your garment and follow me." So he went out and followed him and did not know that what was being done was by an angel was real, but thought he was seeing a vision. When they were past the first and the second guard post, they came to the iron gate that leads to the city, which opened to them on its own accord. And they went out and went down one street, and immediately the angel departed from him. And when Peter had come to himself, he said, "Now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me from the hand of Herod, from all the expectation of the Jewish people." Would you pray with me? God, thank you for this day. Thank you for your word. Thank you that it's the change agent. Thank you that we have an opportunity to be a part of a church that's a movement that's so outside of ourselves. God, thank you for faith and the faith that we walk in. I pray that you remove me. I've got nothing good to say outside of your word. God, but you would use your word to change our hearts today. It's in the mighty name of Jesus we pray. And the church said,
amen.
Excuse me for doing that. I really don't enjoy when other people do that. And I don't have any water, so if you don't have any water, I'm sorry. My throat can't keep up with my schedule these days. It's been wacky. I used to tell my wife all the time, "Do you know you say double the words to me?" And she'd be like, lately she's like, "Not anymore. All you do is go places and talk. You come home, you don't say a word." She would never say that. Let's get into this. Number one. The consistently praying church is birthed out of desperation. The consistently praying church is birthed out of desperation. Peter was therefore kept in prison, but constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. Constant prayer. For who? From who? The church. The church, again. You relegate church to these walls, you become a monument. You are the church. We are the bride of Christ. For do you not know that the Spirit of God dwells in you? So they didn't have a church building. They were holed up somewhere, and they were praying. They were praying out of desperation because this is where life finds them. Jesus has been crucified. Stephen has been martyred. Paul has met Jesus on the road to Damascus in Acts chapter 9. However, you know, everybody's still kind of iffy about Paul. Saul, we talked about him not too many months ago. Herod has just chopped off the head of James, the brother of John, friends with Peter. They were fishing. They all fished together. So James and John, brothers, James's head had just been severed, right? And there was no, and there still is no antibiotic for that. Amen. Done. Well, the Bible says that Herod saw that it pleased the people. So he arrests Peter. And he's going to wait until after Passover. He's going to do the same thing to him. So when I say desperation, I mean Peter's now in a prison that would be the true meaning of a prison. And he is waiting, literally waiting for the same outcome that James had. You got to figure he's part of him because he's human. He's full of sorrow. I mean, he fished with this guy. He knew him since they were kids. Then him, Peter, James, and John decide to follow Jesus. So they spend 3 years on the road, camping out, doing miracles, camping out. Hey, Jesus, we're hungry. Jesus is like, "Fish, get in the boat." And so, but now he's been locked up. He's locked up, yet there is a church. There is a people that are praying for him. I want you to hear this statement. You'll observe that the desire to commune with God is intensified by the failure of all other sources of consolation. In other words, when all other resources have been exhausted, you will find a new vein, a new place in the presence of God, crying out to God, calling out to God that you've never found before. Because you're going through something you've never been through before. It takes faith to go through what you're going through. It takes faith to cry out to God. Faith comes by hearing by the word of God. It takes time. It takes, you can get, like I said, you can get people to do a lot of things, but to pray. Why does the enemy fight prayer so much? Because the enemy knows if we ever get to the bottom of the barrel and we realize we're at the bottom of the barrel and there's no one else to turn except to God, the enemy knows that's exactly where God shows up. Well, first of all, you have to have faith. You have to believe. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, but without faith, it's impossible to please him, for he who comes to God must believe that he is. Did you hear that? He who comes to God, he who comes into the presence of God, he who approaches the throne of grace. You got to believe that he exists. When you believe in who you're talking to, it changes what you ask them, how you talk to them. Someone very close to my life was telling me not too long ago, she said, you know, I wish I could just hit a season, because I asked her, I said, how's your prayer life? And she said, it's good, but I wish I could hit a season where I'm not just always asking God for things. And I'm like, well, you're going through some pretty rough times, and it's okay. But when you get to a place where you can ask and you can worship and you can pray and you can thank and you can ask and you can worship and you can pray and you can thank him and you can ask and you can worship and you can praise and you can thank him. See, but you got to believe who he is. And the Bible says that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. I'm not talking about the level of faith that you have that God's going to answer your prayer. I'm talking about the level of faith that you have that God is God. I'm going to debunk a teaching here for you. Some of you have been taught, you've seen it on TV. Well, you didn't get that miracle because you didn't have enough faith. That's not bad. If you could have enough faith to get what you wanted, if you could have enough faith to make God do what you wanted him to do, then you would be God. Right? But you do have a measure of faith. And that measure of faith is expressed when you come into the presence of God and trust him with your need. See, I know people, I don't trust them. I don't trust a lot of people, like at a high level. I don't trust myself on Mondays. No good on Monday. Don't call me on Mondays. I work. I'm here. There's some people you just don't, you know, like, if they're talking to me about that person like that, you know they're talking to that person about me like that. Like, what? Like, I don't, you know. And there's levels of trust, right? There are very few people in my life that I trust at a level where I will just express to them the deepest desires and needs of my life. Well, when you do that with God, what you're saying is, God, you're there. I know you're there, and I'm trusting you to be there. And so it's not a level of faith to make God do something. It's simply having faith that he is God. The man brings the son to Jesus. He says, can you help us? Every time this demon comes on my son, it throws him in the water, throws him in the fire. And Jesus looks and says, if you believe, all things are possible. Now watch this. That word believe and faith are the same right there. If you have faith, all things are possible. If you believe, all things are possible. Check this out. Here's what the guy says. I believe. Lord, I believe. Very next thing out of his mouth, help my unbelief. Can you relate to that? Yeah. Like, oh God, I believe. Help my unbelief. Jesus does the miracle. So right there we see the parallel of I have faith, but there's a part of me that's still not, I mean, I'm still, there's doubt in me. Like, help the part of me that's doubting. At least the guy was honest enough, right? At least he was honest enough to say, I believe you, but there's a part of me that doesn't understand. And Jesus is like, I can work with that. I'll work with that. Come here. Look, give me that little bit, that mustard seed of faith. Come here, I'm gonna turn that thing into a tree. Right? It's just give you. So you've got to believe in who you're talking to. You've got to, 1 Thessalonians 5 says, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Pray without ceasing. I heard that growing up, and I was like, what in the world does that mean? Driving out, and you know, when I was growing up, if you opened your eyes while you were praying, you were in sin. You know, some religions kneel down every time they pray. Some people pray without sin. What does that mean? That means stay in constant communion with God. Through your trial, through your tribulation, through your storm, stay connected to the vine. Stay in constant communication with the Lord. James 5:16, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. The effective part is on God. The righteous part has already been done by Jesus. The fervent part is on us. Fervently, passionately, intentionally, intensely to intercede. Intercession means to mediate on the behalf of. It means to go to someone on the behalf of another, watch this, with personal knowledge. In other words, I'm so close to them, it's breaking my heart. I know what's going on in their life, so I'm going to get before God and I'm going to intercede fervently, passionately, intently, until I see something change, God. You're not going to stop hearing from me. Most of us don't have the gift of intercession, right? Some people have that gift, but some of us were gifted with ADD, and some of us were gifted with laziness, and some of us were gifted with other wonderful qualities. And, you know, there are people who can lock themselves away in a room and pray for hours on end, and man, and there are those of us, that's hard, but it's necessary. There are times in our life when it's necessary. We're going to do something this week, and I'm going to challenge you, and I'm just going to believe. About a month and a half ago, God laid this on my heart, and you know, just praying over it and then talking with the Lord, and I told Raina, and then Pastor Anthony, who is over much of the spiritual formation here at Coastlines, over the prayer ministry, I was talking with him about it. And when we picked the week to do this, we didn't realize what was happening, but it starts tomorrow, and it's 24-hour-a-day prayer for 7 days a week, 24/7, and it starts on 7/24. Isn't that cool? Yeah. Sounds like a movement to me. So for an entire week, you go to our website, go to our app, and what you can do is click the button, and you can sign up for 30-minute time slots. We as a staff are specifically praying for those in our church body and our families who are battling cancer and other diseases. Cancer is, I've never in my life seen like what I'm seeing right now. And I just believe with all of my heart that we're going to bombard the gates of heaven. And we're just going to see God move. Right? We're going to see him move. I'll talk more about that in a little bit. Hang on. We did this, and before you got in your seat today, it was full. So, this wonderful team you have went in and did whatever needs to be done, and now there are 3 slots for every 30-minute time limit because you're such an amazing church. So, it's not full. Did you hear me? Like, when you go in there, it's going to look empty. And even if it fills up 2 or 3 more times, you can still just email us and say, hey, that slot was full, but I'm doing that. So, now you can clap about that. That's pretty cool. Like, this will change your life. Not to mention, what God does with the prayers, we'll get to that in a little bit. That's up to him. I know it'll change your life because it was probably about 28 years ago, 27 years ago, 28 years ago that I gave my heart back to the Lord. I know I was saved when I was 8 years old and walked away from the Lord, and Raina got saved at our marriage counseling. Started coming home talking about all these guys at church. And it was the church I grew up in, all these godly men. I'm like, hold up. I beat that kid up in the Sunday school. What are you talking about? So, anyway, radically saved. And I can remember those early days of just learning faith, right? Just learning, like, to tithe. I made $330 a week, $33 a week. I never forget writing that check, $33. A couple years down the road, faith promise for missionaries. I looked over at my wife. She's always been this way. I looked over at her, and she just goes, yeah. And I said, well, it's going to, she said, I already know. And, didn't. Well, Pastor Nathan's son-in-law, Dustin, who's been here many times, he's one of our missionaries, but he's a missionary to India, him and Natalie and their precious family. He was at Bible college and just came down with these gnarly headaches. So finally winds up in the ER, and the doctors, some of you heard his story when he was here, the doctors were like, how did you get here? And Dustin's like, well, I did that door down there. And the doctor's like, no, man, you shouldn't even be walking. Just eat up with cancer. He comes back home to Memphis, and the pastor stands up, Pastor Middlebrook, and he said, hey, we're going to do a 24/7 round-the-clock prayer for Dustin. And, you know, when you're, I grew up in church, but just never really, I just didn't get it. And so, like, I'm learning God again. I'm learning the Holy Spirit again. And I felt nudged to do this. And so, you know, this is back when everything was on paper, right? And so, like, your handwriting meant something. And I remember the clipboard, good old clipboards. And I started to write my name by, like, an easy time. You know what I'm saying? Like a, there was hour slots. And I looked up and there's 2 a.m. And I just felt the Lord nudge me. That was like some of the beginning days where I learned how to just feel God, right? Hear him and feel him. 2 a.m. I was working 2 jobs, had 2 small kids. And I think the only sleep I got was between like 1 and 5 back then, and which was enough. I mean, if you're young, don't whine about it, man. Go with no sleep. And enjoy being young. Amen. Because when you get old, you still can't sleep. And stuff hurts. And watch this. I remember this. I remember crawling, setting my alarm, which, yes, was a clock on a nightstand. Wasn't a phone. 1:58, alarm goes off, smack it, roll out of bed, and I'm nervous. I don't know how to pray for 30 minutes, right? I mean, who knows how to pray for 30 minutes? I'm like, I don't think I can do this. And then again, I feel like God, you know, and I'd heard a few people say, you know, just lift Dustin up in prayer. And well, if that's you and you don't think, you can do this. You can talk to God for 30 minutes. You can do it. I tell you that because I can remember the way the carpet felt. I can remember trying desperately not to wake my children up. I can remember the smell, the thoughts of what he must be going through. See, when you begin to pray for something, someone, situation, God will begin to give you compassion. And if you've ever been through it, then the empathy that you have will grow. And before I knew it, it was like 3:15, 3:20. Crying, just weeping. Now, changed my life. Dustin didn't go into remission until I don't know how long after that. It's got the way that this changed my life has nothing to do with the outcome. The outcome is up to the Lord, right? Dustin did get healed. He got healed, went in remission, he's been on the mission field. You heard his story. They fried his whole body, wasn't supposed to be able to have kids. I mean, he'd get close to Natalie and she'd get pregnant. I'm like, dear Lord. Every time they send a new letter, it's like, there's another. Join me in doing this. Let's come together and let's just believe the Lord. Whatever you're going through, don't, and it's not selfish if you pray for yourself. You hear me? Like, you got family stuff, you need breakthroughs. Along the way in there, specifically this week anyway, I believe this is going to go for a while, but this week we're praying against cancer, disease, but also any kind of mental health disease. A spirit of anxiety is a disease. A spirit of suicide is a disease. You hear what I'm saying to you? It will change you. Number two, the power of the consistently praying church brings peace in your prison. How do I have peace in my prison? How do I have peace in bondage? How do I have peace when the enemy seemingly is having his way in my life or those lives around me of people that I love? Listen to this. Prayer is doubt's destroyer, ruin's remedy, and the antidote to all anxieties. That sixth verse of the 12th chapter of Acts, and when Herod was about to bring him out. So Passover is over. It's past. The night before, Peter's going to go get his head chopped off. This is my version. The night before Peter is going to get decapitated, he was very anxious. No. He was really worried. Maybe, but I don't sleep very good when I'm worried. Now, this joker is asleep. He's bound with two chains. He's got a soldier on each side of him, and he's got soldiers keeping guard all around him. And it's because it's the night before, it's his last night alive. It's his last night alive, and he's sleeping. I mean, I can kind of relate to that some days, you know, but no. How do I have peace in what seemingly is a prison? You'll see in a minute, this prison turns into the fertile ground for the working of miracle. But the way that you have peace in your prison is written by Paul, who is very acquainted with prisons. In Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7, be anxious for nothing. Be anxious for no thing. But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. and the peace. There's a methodology. This is what you're going to do. In everything, no thing. Be anxious, no thing. But in everything, pray, ask. Pray and ask with a grateful heart that you had another day to pray and ask. Let your request be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Peter was asleep. Peter wrote in 1 Peter 5:7, cast your care upon him, for he cares for you. Like, you see David write in Psalms 18, verses 5 and 6, the sorrows of hell surrounded me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called upon the Lord. And I, say that with me, to my God. See, there's a difference between calling and crying out. When you get to the place of crying out, you're to that place of desperation. You're to that place of, look, I need peace here because this thing is not going the way I thought it should be going. And David's saying, I cried out to my God. He heard my voice from his temple. And my cry came before him, even to his ears. Now we have one. Read that through a New Testament lens. Now we have one, a great high priest that intercedes for us, who has gone behind the veil to make intercession for you and I. He is not accusing you. He is interceding for you. God is for you. God is for you. God is for you. Don't you believe anything the enemy's saying to you? God is for you. And Jesus has gone behind the veil. He intercedes for you. He prays for you. He stands in the gap for you. Third thing, the power of the consistently praying church positions us in the arena of the supernatural. Whew. Everybody wants to be a part of a miracle, right? Everybody loves to talk about the supernatural. Look, to experience a true miracle, something's got to really, truly be wrong. So you think really hard before you start asking God to allow you to be part of miracles. Because to be a part of a miracle, you're going to have to need a miracle. And to need a miracle ain't no fun. But it's the breeding ground of spiritual champions. Adversity is the breakfast of champions. And so you got somebody in your life that's going through something where they need a miracle. You got to get around them this week. And you got to, not necessarily physically, you got to get around them in prayer and lift them up. But when you're with, you got to speak life. You got to pray, cry out to God. The Bible says you have not because you asked not. Ask, knock, knock again, ask again. And you believe and you shall receive, the Bible says. And so the arena of the supernatural gets so prostituted by the church world that it's not really supernatural. It's a bunch of fluff. Because nobody wants to talk about the dysfunction, the hurt, the sickness that needs healed, the marriage, the family. Like, no one wants to talk. That's where the miracle happens. If that wasn't going on, we wouldn't need a miracle. A miracle is when God restores something back to a right order. Now behold, watch this. This is the arena of the supernatural. Now behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the prison, and he struck Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, arise quickly, and his chains fell off his hands. Quote about prayer. Anything is a blessing if it makes us pray. Come on now. Anything is a blessing if it makes us pray. Charles Spurgeon said that. No, Charlie. Come on, let's just be real. No. But you know, how could he say that? He could say that because it said of him that right beside his bed on the hardwood floor, there were two notches in the floor. And they were put there by his knees. Through years and years and years of waking up in the middle of the night, falling out of bed under the floor, crying out to God. Literal grooves in the hardwood floor were his knees. Literal stains where the tears were hitting the floor. That's the arena for the supernatural. See, the supernatural, miracles cost something. So, Peter's in prison. An angel shows up, because they're everywhere in the Bible. No one likes to talk about them because, you know, but they're awesome. The angel said to him, gird yourself and tie on your sandals. This trips me out. This is a little side note. If he's an angel and he does what he's about to do, and he's going to do it, he smacks him. Like my dad would do some school mornings when he got out of bed. Yeah, it wasn't that. That was like the first time. This was, I'm leaving for work. If you're not out of bed by the time I pull out of the driveway and pull him back in, get up. You see, he wakes him up. The angel said, gird yourself. Put your undergarments on. Put your shoes on. Now, put your garment on. Like, get dressed. I'm thinking to myself, okay, couldn't you just like, and dressed him? Side note, and here's the point. There are many times, God will come to your rescue, but he'll ask you to play a part in that. Right? You ever tried to help somebody get sober that didn't want to get sober? Just give them your phone number and say, when you're ready, give me a call. Right? Because if you don't, like, that's just, put on your garment and follow me. So he went out and followed him, and he didn't know that it was done by the angel. He didn't know what was happening was real. He thought he was seeing a vision. So he thought he was experiencing the supernatural, but he thought he was asleep experiencing the supernatural. Does that make sense? Like, I wish I dreamed more. I don't dream much. And when I dream, they're awesome dreams, but I can't remember them. I don't know. I guess they say everybody dreams. Who knows? Or you have to sleep to dream? Maybe that's the thing. I don't know. So he thinks he's dreaming. Hey. So he went out and followed him and did not know it was real, but he thought he was seeing a vision. So that when the angel shows up, he shows up and there's a desolate situation happening. I think the angel was already there, right? When Peter goes and knocks on the door, right after this, Rhonda, the girl, comes to the door, and she goes back and tells them, and they're like, no, that's probably his angel. That's how comfortable they were with angels. And we're like, angels? That's weird. Well, they're everywhere. I think he was already there. I think when the lights came on, you could see. A great light shined. Angel says, get up. Time to go. Get up. Put your clothes on. It's time to go. My grandmother used to say, look, when God gets ready to move, put your roller skates on. Isn't that so corny? Such a great grandma statement. And man, she prayed. The only woman I've ever known that prays more than that is my wife. I mean, my grandmother prayed. So there's supernatural happening. Remember what I ask you to remember, because there was a church who was in constant prayer. There was a church that was in constant prayer. Paul knows this church. He's in jail in Philippians 1:9. And this, I pray that your love may abound more and more. That's the wrong scripture. It's 19. He says, I know this circumstance will work out for my deliverance because of your prayers and the power of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. He puts prayer and the power of the Holy Ghost in the same sentence. He puts the prayer of your brothers and sisters in Christ and the power of God in the same. He says, I am sure that this situation is going to work out for my deliverance because you are praying and the Holy Ghost is going to move. Philippians 1:19. So, the arena of the supernatural. When you pray prayers of desperation and you are desperate in prayer, there's nowhere else to turn, and you don't see the enemy wants us to quit. That's why we say around here all the time, if you don't quit, you can't lose. Like doubt, fear, worry, just quit. You've been praying about this, just quit. The book of Daniel, chapter 10. Daniel, this is where we get, you know, the Daniel fast and 21-day fast. Daniel starts out on a 21-day prayer journey. And he sees through this journey visions. And some of the things he sees are just amazing. Some of it's interpreted different ways. I believe he sees Jesus the way that it's described there in the bronze. And so suddenly a hand touched me, which made me tremble my knees. This is Daniel talking. And on the palms of my hands, and he said to me, O Daniel, man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak to you and stand upright, for I have now been sent to you. This is an angel telling Daniel, I've been sent to you. While he was speaking this word to me, I stood trembling. Verse 12. Then he said to me, do not fear, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand, day one, my God, day one, when he said, Lord, because he knows the intent. He knows what's in our mouth before it comes out. He knows what's in our heart, right? So at the very mention of the Lord's name, the first day one of the 21 days, Lord, as soon as he opened his mouth and began to make those requests known, heaven heard. But it took the angel 21 days to get there. Now, some of y'all don't read the Bible. You're going to be like, this is weird. This is not in the Bible. This is so weird. I'm not going back to that church. That's weird. Read your Bible. The angel said, listen, don't be afraid. From the first day that you set your heart to understand and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard. And I have come because of your words, because of your prayers. Day one, day five, day 10, no change. Month 11, no change. Year 2, no change. Ask, knock, seek, believe. Keep going. Our part is not to determine the outcome. Our part is just to ask the Lord for his kingdom to come and his will to be done. The angel shows up and says, since the first day we heard you. But I've been held up by the prince of Persia. A demon that was over the region of Persia, very dark place. Well, demons are only just fallen angels, right? See, some of you are like, that's why you don't want to talk about angels, because then you got to think about demons. Anyway, just get your information from the Bible, not Hollywood. So he said, I was held up by the prince of Persia. I love this. There was a wrestling match going on. They were locked. You know, during mating season, you ever seen those rams that'll hit? They get on their back. It's so stupid. They, like teenage boys, man. they'll get on their back feet. And then they'll get to galloping on their, back feet. And then they come down together just at the right time. They're just like, wham. You've never seen that? Okay, yeah. Sometimes their horns will get locked up. You know, they can't get. So he's locked up. He said, so I had to call up the food chain a little bit. And Michael, the head angel, the archangel, came to relieve me. I kind of view like Michael just walking in the, like, I don't want to say room because it's in the spirit, or I don't know. But Michael walking on the scene, and then the Prince of Persia going, you may pass. You know, Michael is like, it. Here's the point, man. The minute Daniel opened his mouth for God to move, he was heard. This consistent prayer of not giving up, not quitting. See, Daniel could have removed himself from a posture that would eventually receive the vision and the answer to his prayer. It's the container. You got to keep your container ready. The power of the consistently praying church releases God's will and removes every obstacle of the enemy. When they were past the first and the second guard post, they came to the iron gate that leads to the city, which opened to them of its own accord, and they went out and went down one street, and immediately the angel departed from them. This is what I came to ask you today. What is your iron gate? What have you been trying to push down, winch open, wedge open, kick open, knock open, bulldoze over, pay enough money to get through? See, cities had iron gates because gates block breaks in the wall. But they weren't gates like you and I think about gates. They were, this one was iron. So if an army were to attack at night, they would first have to either come over the wall or they have to figure out a way. They didn't have equipment to go through iron gates then. Matter of fact, if a city had an iron gate, it was a very fortified city because most of them were wood. So what is it? What's that iron? What is that gate? What is that iron gate? What is it where you've exhausted resource to a place of now just saying, you know what? If God doesn't do this, it's not going to get done. Because the Bible says they passed the guards, Jedi fashion. They came to the iron gate that leads to the city, and it opened to them of its own accord. That just don't happen. This massively iron gate. Peter, I'm going to make you get dressed because you can do that. You can put your sandals on and you can put your clothes on. Don't want you embarrassing yourself. But you can't open that gate. But I'll do that for you. Man, I'm telling you, gates are a place that secure a break in the wall. Jesus looks at Peter and says, Cephas, on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Keys. Prayer is a key. Prayer is a key that will unlock an arena that perhaps you've never experienced before. And the church that is constantly praying, God will perform his will. I mean, Matthew 6:10, let your kingdom come, let your will be done. 1 John 5:14-15. Now, this is the confidence that we have in him, and if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we ask of him. He hears you when you cry out. The power of the consistently praying church brings about the deliverance of God. Such a cool story. And when Peter had come to himself, he said, See, this is the testimony on the other side of the miracle. Now, you got to realize, Peter's crucified upside down. Jack was with us all week for VBS. He said, Gaga, can you die of old age? And Raina said, I hope so. You know? Here's what I'm saying. I'm just telling you, it didn't all turn out hunky-dory for Peter, but I guarantee you it is right now in heaven. Right? I mean, he died a champion. Now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angel. That's the testimony. Since the iron gate opened, and I was here, but now I'm here. I was bound, but now I'm free. I was about to get my head cut off, but oh no, I still got 2 books of the Bible to write. See, I was this, but that ain't this. And so Peter's able to say, now, because of all that, now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angel and delivered me from the hand of Herod and from all the expectations of the Jewish people. Now I know it was God who did the miracle. Now no man can get the glory. Now I know it was him, because it was him I put my trust in. Surely I would have lost heart had I not believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. When you pray this week, pray in faith that God, I know we're going to see it in heaven. Let your will be done in heaven, on earth, as it is in heaven. Lord, your word says we can see your goodness here. We can see your goodness now. We can see your goodness on this earth. We can see your goodness in our bodies. We can see your goodness in our families. We can see your goodness in our finance. We can see your goodness in our businesses. We can see your goodness in our church. We can see your goodness in our community. We can see your goodness, yes, I'm gonna say it, in our governments. We can see your goodness. We can see your goodness in the land of the living. So I will not lose heart. I will not lose heart. I will not stop praying. Listen, my job, our job, again, is not to create an outcome. See, you hear the devil say things. Even preaching this message, I've heard it today. Jason, how can you preach a message like that? What if it doesn't work out? What if God doesn't? What if? When I stand before God, he is not going to hold me accountable for what he didn't do, because he's God. He'll hold me accountable for not encouraging you to do what you can do, and what we can do is just pray. So I'm asking you to do that this week. You know, Revelation 5:8 says, now when he had taken the scroll, the 4 living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are, say it with me, this is so awesome. That means there are bowls that hold our prayers. Well, what happens to a bowl when it gets full? It tips over. I believe this. I believe it to the core of my being. You can ask people who are closest to me. I believe the coastline. I don't pastor the Church of America. I pastor this church. I believe Coastline is at a tipping point in the most amazing way. What happens to a bowl when it gets full is it tips. And whatever's in that bowl, it gets poured out. Come on. There were prayers prayed for me probably 20, 30, 40 years before I got right with God. And maybe it was that one last prayer and it was just like, tipping point. I've seen it. Here's the way that that's working. Unfortunately, when something flows, when the anointing oil flows, when the healing oil flows, when someone was anointed, the oil was poured on their head. It's poured on the head first. Come down over the face and the beard if you had one. Onto the robe, onto the tassels of the robe, to the body. He was crushed. He was bruised. He's the head. The people who help spiritually lead this church, serve this church, I've never seen such an attack against a group of people ever in my life. That's why I know like we're at a tipping point. And to lead people into the supernatural and the miracles that he's going to do in this community, in this house, he's saying, I've got to walk you through this first. Because if you don't know the way, you can't take anyone. See, that's why I can tell you, be careful praying about wanting the miraculous. Because by the time you start, if you really mean that, you really need it. Here's the good thing. We win. We win. That bowl's going to tip. We win. And the outcome is not our responsibility. Our responsibility is simply just to pray and not give up. Would you bow your head? Father, I pray that you would encourage, challenge, move our hearts to first believe that you hear us when we pray. To believe that you care. Challenge us to pray about the situation more than we talk about it. Lord, remind us that whatever faith we have, even as small as a mustard seed, you can work with that. Lord, as these precious people hit that button and sign up for those time slots, I pray that you would lay specific needs of people, specific issues, and there would just be an influx of prayers in that bowl you're holding over Coastline. And God, as we come back into the night of prayer next Monday night, let it just be a night of celebration. Not because you've done miracles already or whatever, just because of your goodness and just because we have touched your throne room and you've given us a fresh wind and a fresh fire and a fresh faith to keep going and keep fighting. As your heads are bowed, perhaps you're here and you say, Pastor Jason, I've never been saved. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord, you shall be saved. If you need to give your heart to Jesus, you slip your hand up. I need to do that today. Would you stand up with me all around this place? Stand up. Prayer team's coming forward. I just have to tell you, you are some of the most precious people I know. And I'm so proud of some of you who are battling and warring and showing up to church. You got heavy stuff going on in your life. Plot on. You don't quit, you can't lose. Right? I mean, we're going to get through this. We will get through this. Let me encourage you. You are surrounded by people that love you, and we're going to pray for you this week. We might not even know you, but we're going to pray for you. Because God knows you. He knows what you're going through. So you're going to get prayed for this week. You don't even know it. God's going to move, and you're going to be like Peter. You're going to say, now I know. Surely it was God. May the Lord bless you and keep you, His face shine upon you, and everything you do this week prosper. Amen. I love you so much. You are dismissed.